business processes that undergo transformation. To the degree that you implement a managed services operating model based on results achieved, your organization will be transformed. The management structure, skills required, along with the responsibilities, careers, and management of people will all need to change. Then there's the risk of losing core knowledge. To help clients manage these changes, migrating to the new operating model, determining roles and responsibilities in the retained organization, staff transfer, and holding on to core knowledge. Infosys has built a client human resources and organizational change management practice that has successfully partnered with clients on hundreds of programs across five continents and dozens of countries. We can help optimize your organizational structure and determine the skill sets required for your retained staff organization to operate effectively in the new model. We know how to manage staff transfers across countries and cultures correctly and positively. Our philosophy on staff transfer is simple. Whether the people are IT, BPO, or consulting professionals, what they do is core to what we do. So, investment in their future is an investment in Infosys' future. Moving to a managed services operating model transforms not just how work gets done, but the organization itself. Infosys Human Resources and Organizational Change Management Practice will help you make sure it's the right organization. Because how you get to your new operating model is as important as getting there. Infosys, building tomorrow's enterprise.
All right, and these are the kinds of ideas we want to talk about. What should we be actually doing about this? Vishal, I don't know where I was reading in my studying for this, but Foxconn, we all know about. You know, if you've got an iPad or iPhone, they assemble them. Foxconn has 10,000 computers, right? 10,000 robots at the moment that do things that humans were doing. By next year, I believe they'll have 300,000 robots. And in 3 years, they will have 1 million robots doing things like painting, assembling, putting these things together.
We have one in our booth serving beer tonight.
Well, there you go. So I would have thought serving beer was safe.
The German way, you know, with the inclined glass and everything.
Right, so the point is, and we'll get to this.
And Ollie, if that's not progress, nothing is.
That's right. So I guess my issue is when Laura talks about minimum wage, and in the United States there's a big movement toward a $15 minimum wage. The president has embraced $10 and change as a minimum wage, but people are saying $15. Well, if we already are outsourcing jobs because we want to pay $15 to people, and you're outsourcing jobs to computers, and Foxconn is laying off peasant workers, what hope is there for labor?
Look, my view on this is very simple. Automation is inevitable. The advance of AI is inevitable. We have to embrace that. The world needs more intelligent systems, more of these dynamic adaptive systems. And there is no way, I mean, it is an unstoppable force of nature, and we have to treat it that way, and we have to embrace that. And frankly, my view on this is quite simple. There is no limit to human creativity. There is, for the foreseeable future, my own education is in AI, and I don't see that for the foreseeable future, there is any shortage to the kinds of things that people can do, that there isn't a fundamental, irreplaceable reason why people won't have jobs if we don't gear ourselves up to enable and to provide those kinds of jobs. So the answer lies in enabling people to become more creative, more innovative, going after innovation, going after the construction of these kinds of intelligent systems. And the way to enable that is quite straightforward, that is education. The way that we educate people, and we have to provide access to jobs, we have to provide much more transparent, and there are all kinds of marketplaces that are available now that lower the friction in between supply and demand. We have to go after ideas like that, but at its root, the issue is one of education that has to enable people to find their own creativity, their own purpose.
Okay, so let's talk about that. Laura, you mentioned retraining. Guy, at any given time in most modern Western markets in the United States, there's a certain amount of churn. There are always jobs available. But since the Great Recession, we have had far more people available than jobs. So if you retrain them all to be software engineers, every manufacturing worker in the United States, we still don't employ them all. So to what degree is this about educating people properly, people who are not educated for this knowledge economy that we're in? And to what degree is this something else, where we are eliminating jobs faster than we can create the capital to create new work?
Yeah, I think the first point to be made is we're starting from a bad place. Never helpful in a debate. We're starting in a very sluggish global economy, with very high levels of unemployment already, and the trends going in the wrong direction still. And now if we see an unfurling second or fourth revolution, it depends whose book you read, we're going to have to deal with some very difficult situations from a bad starting point. Now, I spend a lot of my time railing against techno-determinism, as I call it. I don't know if you have any techno-determinists on the panel. But the point is the following. I think, and I like the title of the panel, because I think progress is not to be measured in technical advance or innovation. It is to be measured by what we make of the application of that advance and that application. I think there's one fundamental question where the jury is out, or at least I hear very contrasting opinions. If we are going round this carousel for the second time or the fourth time, let's look at the lessons of what happened previously. And I think the optimists would say, well, we all know about creative destruction, and we all know that after a period of turbulence, which people did either pretty well or very badly in managing, we came out ahead in terms of better living standards, distributive mechanisms, and jobs. So just let it happen. I even heard somebody at OECD last week say it's going to take 7 years to get out ahead.
7 years.
It's sort of, you know, nice to have that sort of guarantee. Or is it different this time?
Mm-hmm.
Is there something qualitatively different? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a lot of reasons to think that it could be different, but not just measured on that sort of, you know, spectrum.